walls into the auditorium simply because the lighting, of course, in 18th century theatres was extremely dim with candles, and so the stage would project right into the auditorium so that the actors could be seen, the actors and singers, and in many cases they would actually converse or sing to the people sitting in the side boxes, so that it was almost, for some of the audience, almost like watching the television. You know, you could see the faces right up close. Here, of course, we're looking from the stage backwards in La Scala, and suffice it to say for the moment, the theatre form of opera houses, the Italian Baroque theatre style, remained more or less unchanged for 300 years. It was very successful as a formula because opera houses, like theatres for drama, need to have very clear acoustics to reveal speech. When I say speech, that could be the spoken word or, in the case of opera, of course, the singing. The reverberation time has to be very short, and clarity reveals the tongue-twisting arias of Mozart and Rossini, which in a more reverberant auditorium like a concert hall would make the singers quite unintelligible. Now, in the 18th century, they knew nothing about acoustics at all, but the formula, as it were, of the Baroque opera house worked well, and the secret was simply that the balcony fronts, the gallery fronts, reflect sound very usefully and keep the sound very bright, but there was lots of absorption in the theatre provided by the people in their boxes. If we have a look at the boxes from a slightly different angle, you can see the form they took. So the combination of sound absorption by the audience and by the boxes and the sound reflection of the balcony fronts provided this very clear but lively acoustic, which was very good. As I say, they knew nothing about acoustics at that time, and it was simply the fact that buildings that worked well lasted, and those that were acoustically disastrous were usually demolished or used for a different purpose within 50 years of their life. So, as I say, the architects in the 18th century knew very little. In Italy, particularly, the social requirements of opera goers was to have these little boxes. That's to say, the galleries were partitioned into what Proust, I think, called little drawing rooms, and the patrons would often furnish them in their own taste, hanging draperies, and they would have supper in there and play cards, sometimes gambling, all kinds of things. And here we are inside one of the boxes. What you can see on the left-hand side is actually a mirror. So the opening of the box is the aperture on the right-hand side. And I say that opera houses have very good acoustics. In fact, one should qualify that by saying that the acoustics for the people in the boxes were only good for those at the front of the boxes. And for those at the rear of the boxes, they both saw and heard very little. But it's interesting that changes in social behaviour and social patterns actually affected the acoustics of the boxes. For example, in Rome in the mid-18th century, at the opera house in Rome, there was a great deal of hanky-panky going on. Do you know what I mean by hanky-panky? You know, people doing naughty things. And so the authorities in Rome demanded that the partitions between the boxes be removed, and as a consequence, the acoustics improved overnight. Now, different countries have different social requirements, and as I say, the Italians certainly required their little boxes, but the opera theatres in Germany and France, for example, didn't require such social intimacy and the galleries in Germany and France were often open, or at least with no partitions between the boxes. And here we have a drawing of an unbuilt court opera house for Stuttgart by an architect called Philippe de la Guéhière, and it shows the open galleries with people being able to see each other quite freely. I would also point out the slightly odd architecture of this interior. On the ground floor, the columns are sort of spindles, and on the middle level, the columns are carved to represent palm trees, and on the upper level, there are caryatids, human forms, appearing to support the architecture. But more relevant to what we're talking about is the orchestra. I want you to notice the members of the orchestra, because in the 18th century, musical instruments were much less powerful than they are today, and the orchestra was quite a lot smaller. So they got around this by not having sunken pits. The heads and shoulders of the musicians would be above the level of the stage, so that the audience could hear more clearly the musicians accompanying the singers. And this was also the case at the Teatro Reggio in Turin, which was a very highly regarded opera house at that time. And this drawing shows the opening night. And again, you can see the musicians are not sunken below view. You can see them quite clearly, especially on the right and left-hand sides with the double basses and the horns. It's also quite interesting to notice the people selling drinks and fruit during the performance, because it was quite common to talk, to chat, and eat and drink and so on. And there's also the security guard there with his musket, his firearm, standing in the aisle. As I say, it was a very highly regarded opera house, and it had some rather curious acoustic devices which were common to many opera houses at that time. And this is a design for an ideal opera house by the French architect Pierre Pat, or Pate, based on the Teatro Reggio in Turin. And for those of you that can see the bottom of the screen, you will notice the semi-cylindrical trough underneath the orchestra pit, which was a common device because the sound was thought to reflect. There was grills in the floor, and it was thought to sort of amplify the sound. And in some theatres, they even had great canals or sources of water and masonry underneath the main floor, with grills, and they said at the time that these were very effective and very useful. In reality, the effect must have been very slight, but they thought that it was beneficial to the sound. Let's go back to the beginning, though. In the 16th century, what we're looking at is Andrea Palladio's Teatro Olimpico in Vicenza. In the 16th century, it was thought that a wonderful way of recreating classical forms of art was to perform Greek classical plays within a classical style amphitheatre, either Roman or Greek. And this is exactly what Andrea Palladio constructed from 1580, before opera as we know today was invented. All opera houses tended to derive from this form, as we will see. As I say, there's the amphitheatrical seating, and this is surrounded by a colonnade of columns at the back, and at the front is the scaenae frons, which is a Latin word meaning the architectural backdrop to the stage, which was common to Roman theatres. although by the time that Andrea Palladio built his theatre, this form was already rather out of date. But the feature of the Scaenae Fronds in this case is that there were three openings with street scenes, and the streets were at angles so that the audience, wherever they were sitting, could at least see one of the streets. And the streets were deliberately made into a perspective form so that the streets looked much longer than they actually were. And it was quite common in theatres from that time and onwards to dress up children in adults' clothes and put them at the back so that they looked as if they were adults, and it heightened this illusion of great depth to the scenery. And then in 1618, well, between 1618 and 28, there was constructed the Teatro Farnese in Parma by an architect called Aleotti, and he kept the amphitheatrical form of Palladio's theatre, but he extended the sides into a U-shape. But we still have the colonnade around the back, and so it remains still the classical amphitheatre form. But here at Parma, there was a stage, more or less as we know it, but the flat floor in the middle could also be used for the action. And in fact, on the opening night, it was all rather exciting because the performance, which was a play called Mercury and Mars, set to music by Monteverdi, it culminated in a huge sea fight, a huge sea battle, started by Neptune, and this was only quelled when Jupiter descended from the ceiling with a great chorus, and everything was then resolved. As I say, the colonnade around the back remained, but eventually, especially in the early opera houses in Venice, the colonnade became, as it were, inhabited by people, and hence the invention of boxes instead of the colonnade of columns. And here we see the common form of plan shape on the right-hand side is the Teatro San Carlo in Naples, which we'll revisit in a few minutes' time, which is a truncated ellipse, that's to say an oval that is sort of cut off, as it were. Notice the stage projecting into the auditorium. On the lower left, we have a similar plan form, loosely called a horseshoe-shaped plan. And then in the upper left, we have a truncated circle, which is the Teatro at Bordeaux. Again, we'll have a glance at that a little later on. There was, however, a further plan shape, and that was the flared bell shape, as I call it, which was the hallmark of a great family of theatre designers called the Galli Bibbiena. Their name was Galli, and they came from Bibbiena near Bologna, so they were known as the Galli Bibbiena. And they lasted throughout the 18th century as several generations of theatre designers and set designers, and they worked at courts all over Europe. Their characteristic plan shape, as I say, was a flaring bell shape. And I won't go into technical detail, but the flaring shape, or reverse plan, as I call it, was actually very good acoustically because it caused the sound reflections from the singers to go to the ears of the people in the middle of the auditorium. I won't show diagrams or anything, but take the word for it, the plan form worked well, although unfortunately the Galli Bibbiena brothers never said anything about acoustics at all, and there was a sort of myth at that time that the analogy of the bell shape was beneficial because it was like a bell, but that was a lot of nonsense really. The other thing to notice though, which is very interesting in this design, which by the way is the Teatro Filarmonico in Verona, which only lasted a few years until it was burned down, is the stepped boxes in the left, top left-hand corner. As I say, the boxes step, so that improved the sight lines. And that technique of arranging the boxes in that way has carried through, in many cases, right through to today. And in fact, one of the very final opera houses that I'll show you uses that technique, which was invented in the 18th century. I mentioned that the, I'll just go back to it, I mentioned that the theatre burnt down very soon after it was built. And I once worked out that the average life of a theatre before building codes came in to introduce proper fire precautions in the late 19th century was only 18 years. On average, theatres burned down after 18 years because of the live flames and so on from the candles. And of course, there was an enormous loss of life as well, needless to say. This is a so-called ideal theatre designed by an English surveyor called Saunders in 1790. And he didn't adopt the truncated ellipse or horseshoe shape for his ideal plan, but instead the truncated circle. And that had the advantage, which was very true, of bringing people closer to the stage than was otherwise possible. But the problem is, and what they didn't realise, was that concave shapes are very hazardous acoustically because they focus sound. Convex shapes are actually the best, but in those days they thought exactly the opposite was the case. And although this theatre wasn't built, Benjamin Wyatt at the Theatre Royal Drury Lane in London did adopt the design of Saunders, and it was actually acoustically disastrous. You got a funny focusing sound of the acoustics, and also Saunders hadn't worked out the sightlines of the boxes properly. So in Benjamin Wyatt's theatre, the people in the boxes could largely not see the stage properly, and that theatre was demolished and rebuilt in 1822. The French, however, at the end of the 18th century, the neoclassical French architects, were very much part of a movement of ideal thinkers and moves towards democracy. And this movement happened before the French Revolution, but it all builds up to the revolution. The idea of giving people equality, democracy, and doing away with aristocracy. And you can see the way in which this all led up to the French Revolution. So here we see a theatre which was actually built at Besançon by the great neoclassical architect Le Doux. And it's in the form of an amphitheatre, obviously seen through the pupil of an eye here, because the amphitheatre gave this sense of democracy and reduced the idea of elitism, which the boxes were essentially all about. And the French architects, the neoclassical architects, liked pure geometrical forms in reaction to the Baroque and Rococo shapes and decoration of earlier theatres. So they went in for circles and squares and so on. And so the truncated circular auditorium suited their ideals very well. This is an image of Joseph Haydn, and I won't say very much about Haydn, because he is very much a lecturer in himself. But the point I want to make is that composers in the 18th century, and indeed subsequently, very often adapted their music according to the acoustic spaces for which they were writing. And Joseph Haydn was a very good example, because he was working for the Prince Esterhazy over much of his lifetime, first of all working at Esterhazy Palace, where the music room was quite small and intimate and acoustically dry or non-reverberant, and then he was moved on to Eisenstadt Palace, where the music room there was much more like a chapel and very reverberant. And then he moved on to London, where he completed his final symphonies, because he wrote over 100 symphonies, composing these specifically for the concert hall of the King's Theatre in London, which was a very reverberant space, and he altered his orchestration and manner of composition accordingly. Again, I won't go into detail, but it wasn't quite so simple as altering the tempo or speed of the music, but rather altering the rate of change of harmony. But I won't go into any further musical or technical detail than that. But also, just to say of Haydn, he wrote operas for the opera house at the palace, but that too burned down, and he moved on to the marionette theatre, the puppet theatre which they had there, and he wrote operas for puppets. You know what I mean by puppets, little wooden dolls on strings that could walk along and so on. But unfortunately, that theatre caught fire and destroyed all of Haydn's marionette operas and one or two of his other operas as well. So that again, is part and parcel of the theme of fire. So let's look at a number of opera houses that do actually still exist. And I first of all want to show you a number of court opera houses and private opera houses, simply to introduce the idea that the finest opera houses are small and intimate because people are nearer to the stage. And the easiest way to make clear acoustics so that you can hear the singers and their words is to be seated near to the stage. So naturally, a small theatre is a very good theatre acoustically and, of course, visually as well. So this is the Margrave's Opera House in Bayreuth. Now, I'm mentioning Bayreuth, and those of you who are Wagner fans will associate Bayreuth with Wagner, but this is not Wagner's theatre. He was offered the theatre when he moved to Bayreuth, 100 and something years after this theatre was built, and luckily he didn't accept it. It was obviously not suitable for his operas. But the theatre exists to this day and is a wonderful little architectural gem in some ways, my favourite buildings, I guess. Here we're obviously looking towards the stage, and here we're looking, of course, to the royal box at the rear. It's called the Margrave's Opera House. The Margrave was the word used for the ruler of Bayreuth. But it was really his wife, the Margravine, who was interested in opera, and she used to write short operas herself and would perform from time to time in the theatre itself. I mentioned before about the matter of sound reflection and sound absorption. If you visit this theatre and tap the walls, you'll find that the walls are lined with very thin wood panelling. They sound hollow, and the effect of that acoustically is that the lower frequency sound, when meeting the thin panelling on the walls, is absorbed. The lower frequency sound is absorbed, but the upper frequency sound is reflected, and it's the upper frequency sound and strength of the upper frequencies that one requires for revealing the clarity of speech. Now, if it was a concert hall, the exact opposite would apply. You would be lining the hall with very solid sound reflective surfaces. But it was well known in the 18th century that thin wood panelling was beneficial in an opera house, although they believed that for the wrong reason. They thought that thin wood panelling vibrated like a musical instrument, but in fact that's not the case. That was a total myth. But it was a myth, by the way, that lasted right up until the 1950s, and acousticians know better. But going back to what I said, successful halls remain with us if they went down, and unsuccessful halls were demolished. Now, I mentioned that the flaring bell shape was the hallmark of the Galli Bibbiena family. also influential in terms that other architects also sometimes use this formula. And a good example of this is the Residenztheater at the court in Munich. The Residenz is the name of the palace in Munich, where the Elector, which was the name of the ruler of Bavaria, almost like the king of Bavaria, where he lived, and the Elector had this theatre built, and you can see a cross-section of the theatre to see what it looked like, again, those of you that can see the bottom of the screen will see the stage machinery that could raise and lower the main floor or parterre so that it would be raked or sloping during performances so that people could see the stage, and it could be made flat for putting on balls and banquets and that sort of thing. Now, the theatre exists to this day, or at least the interior does, because during the war, Second World War, it was bombed. But luckily, they took out all the interior fittings, put them into storage, and they rebuilt the theatre in the 1950s, although in a different part of the palace, in a different part of the residence, to the original, but nonetheless they recreated the theatre. And the story of the architect is rather curious. The architect was a Belgian called François Cuvillier, and he started out life at the court of the Elector as the court dwarf, because he was very, very tiny, very small. And they used to sort of bake him in pie, well, not literally bake him, but they would put him in a large pie dish and put pastry over him and put the pie on the table at banquets, and then he would jump out and make everybody laugh. And the Elector noticed, though, that he was very good at drawing, and he sent him to Paris to study court architecture. When he came back, he was appointed the court architect, and he built this theatre. So the style of the theatre is very different to the Margrave's Opera House. It is very much in the style of French Rococo, very much lighter, more light-hearted. And there you can see, looking backwards towards the Elector's box, the lightness that it achieved in terms of decoration. But the main thing to point out here in this slide is that the you see the red drapery over the edge of the galleries. That is not actually cloth at all. It's actually carved wood, and the court wood carver, a man called Picler, carved all the balcony fronts to look like drapery, and had them all painted red. And this has the acoustical benefit of scattering or diffusing the sound so that the members of the audience hear the sound very evenly. They knew nothing about this, of course, in the 18th century, but nonetheless, fortunately, it did have this effect. And you can perhaps just see the frivolous architecture, the caryatids, and the palm fronds instead of real columns. Here I just show the antiquarium at the residence. It's got nothing to do with opera, but I've just put it in because it's a wonderful space. It's actually the first interior designed specifically for works of art, for sculptures, and it was built in about 1570, and it was really the sort of world pioneer for art museums, and it remains to this day the most important secular Baroque interior in Germany. By secular, I mean a place nothing to do with churches. Here we come to a private theatre, which again is very, very small indeed, and as I say, small equals excellence in acoustical terms. This is the Teatro di Villa Mazzacorati Aldrovandi in Bologna, or just outside the gates of Bologna, on the way to Florence. And it's a very charming theatre which exists to this day. It was nearly demolished in the 1950s. It was altered a little bit with that rather nasty floor, and the stage was cut back. It would have projected originally into the auditorium. But it's basically there, and as you can see, the balconies are supported by these figures. When I say supported, they're not literally, structurally supported by the figures, because the figures are just made of plaster. And the hands, as you can see, of the figures are outstretched, and for performances they used to string garlands of flowers between them to make a very decorative effect. And the owner of the villa would actually often perform with his friends on stage. Here we are looking back from the stage, where you can see the two gallery levels, the two balconies with the figures. And here again, we get a sense of the intimacy of the theatre, which is, as I say, the key to its acoustical success. And that's simply the exterior, which is a neo-Palladian villa, containing the theatre in one of the wings. And here we come on to the Opera House of Versailles, the court of the Sun King, Louis XIV and his successors. And it's remarkable, in fact, that although huge amounts of opera was staged at Versailles, Versailles itself didn't have a court opera house until 1770. They always built temporary opera houses in the grounds whenever they wanted to celebrate a marriage and so on. But then when Marie Antoinette, the daughter of the Habsburg Emperor from Austria, was to marry the future King Louis XVI, it was decided by Louis XV to build a permanent theatre, because it was just so expensive to keep building theatres and demolishing them. So this is a supremely delightful interior, built relatively economically, because the walls are built of wood panelling, painted to represent marble, and that is a view, of course, towards the stage with the ceiling paintings. And here we have a view of the gallery levels with, on the right-hand side, the box with a grill over it where the king would sit. And so you couldn't see the king, but the king could see the performance. And again, I've just put this one in because it's the famous Hall of Mirrors of Versailles. By the architect Mansart. This is a lot earlier than the theatre itself, because Mansart died in 1707. But those of you who know your architecture will associate Mansart with the Mansart roof, a particular form of roof. But here, Mansart produced the Hall of Mirrors, or Salle des Glaces, which is such a delightful interior to this day. And this is Marie Antoinette's theatre in the grounds of Versailles. Marie Antoinette inherited, as it were, a little area in Versailles called the Petit Trianon, which had been the sort of playground of Madame de Pompadour. Marie Antoinette would spend a lot of time at the Petit Trianon. She re-landscaped it to obliterate any memories of the infamous Madame de Pompadour. She changed all the gardens there from formal planting to English style, with curling, twisting paths and so on. But more to the point, she commissioned and built this tiny little miniature opera house, and it only held 100 people, and the walls are painted to resemble marble and fabric and so on. And she would often perform operas with her friends, and to create an audience, she would often put her servants in the audience. So it was a kind of role reversal, a very unusual thing at that time. But she could do these things in the privacy of the Petit Trianon without the public or the king getting to know very much about what was going on. And now we come to the Court Opera House at Drottningholm in Sweden, just near Stockholm. And this is an amazing court opera house in that it's a complete time warp from 1793. And you can see the stage with its original stage sets. And in the at the back of the stage, you can see ships with waves. And there was a wave machine down below the stage, which made the effect of waves. And all that exists to this day. And they put on performances at a festival each year. There was no royal box in this theatre. And unusually, the king and his wife, the queen, would sit in at the front on two chairs, two thrones, right in front of the stage, which must have been rather intimidating, I always think, for the performers. But that was what they did at Drottningholm. King Gustav III, who built the theatre, loved opera and couldn't get enough of it. The side walls are painted with trompe l'oeil paintings, and that's a view of the stage. The bench seating, the blue seating, is all original. Most theatres, even when they're very old, have had the seating renewed many times, but here the seating is original. And just to go back to this image, the story behind the theatre is rather intriguing and accounts for why it's a time warp from 1793, because, as I say, Gustav III loved opera. One night he went to a masked ball, not here at Drottningholm, but in Stockholm itself, and all the guests were in black cloaks and masks. At the ball, there were three noblemen who had a grudge against the king. They had been arrested for some relatively minor offence some time before. But one of the three noblemen recognised the king because he had a large sort of gold badge on his tunic. And the nobleman pulled out a pistol and shot the king in the back. And he died 2 weeks later. And of course the three noblemen were arrested, and I won't go into detail of what happened to them exactly, but they were executed anyway a number of days later. And the successor to Gustav III wasn't interested in opera at all, and so the theatre was closed up and just used as a store, or just left empty, right up till the 1920s, when a professor quite literally sort of discovered it and had the place brought back to life. But the end of my story about Gustav III was that the tale inspired Verdi, and the story of Verdi's opera Un ballo in maschera, The Masked Ball. The Masked Ball opera was a kind of gruesome reflection of real life, a very interesting and unusual story. At Drottningholm, the stage machinery exists like everything else, and when they dusted off the opera house in the 1920s, they had very little to do except literally dust it off, and they renewed the ropes to the stage machinery, but that was all they had to do. Here we move on to larger opera houses now, and here we have another one of the theatres by the Galli di Vienna, and this is the Teatro Comunale in Bologna. Bologna had been a great commercial centre since the Middle Ages, and also a great cultural centre. The university there had had a music department from 1470, plus a music professor, and so this theatre was built in 1753, and it must have been a supremely delightful theatre when it was built, because Galli di Vienna built it all of stone, so the interior must have looked like a kind of inside-out building, you know, the facade of a building. But because it was built of stone, and going back to what I'd said earlier, stone reflects sound, and as a result it was very poor acoustically for opera. And so it was demolished and rebuilt in a more sympathetic material. But I always think that it was a great shame that they didn't simply relabel it concert hall and put on orchestral performances there, because for that purpose it would have been ideal. And here we see the ceiling, where you can see the characteristic bell shape. And here we move on to the Grand Théâtre in Bordeaux by the architect Victor Louis. You remember we saw at the beginning the plan, the truncated circular plan. Although it is a circular shape, unlike Saunders' ideal plan, it does have enough diffusing surfaces to scatter the sound and avoid an acoustical problem. The architect Victor Louis didn't build a great deal else apart from this theatre, and he spent some time in Italy, and when he came back he was never admitted to the architectural establishment in France, because he had sent some drawings to a very famous archaeologist, and he claimed that these drawings were of newly discovered antiquities, and in fact he made them all up himself, and the deception didn't go down very well. They were not amused by this, and so he always remained something of an architectural outsider. And this is the grand staircase. But it did form the inspiration for Charles Garnier at the Paris Opera House, which we'll see shortly. And this is the main foyer on the main floor, which originally was a concert hall but converted into the foyer in the 19th century. And here we move to Lisbon, just to again illustrate the fact that the Italian Baroque opera house form became ubiquitous, became very common, very standard. And this opera house was built following a great disaster in Lisbon, because at 10:30 on Saturday morning, the 1st of November 1755, there was a huge earthquake, and the whole city was demolished, and the citizens, tens of thousands of people lost their lives, and it was one of the worst earthquakes that has ever been in history. And eventually by the 1790s the opera house was rebuilt, the city itself having been replanned, which was of course the priority, but the opera house nonetheless got rebuilt, although the king of Portugal actually left Portugal in 1808 after Napoleon invaded the country. He fled to Rio de Janeiro in Brazil, and quite shortly afterwards the architect of the theatre fled as well and joined him. The architect was an architect called De Silva e Costa, and he had a lot of influence on the design of the opera house in Rio de Janeiro. So that is the story there. Here we move to Naples, and this is the Teatro San Carlo in Naples, which at the time was the biggest opera house anywhere, and it was very grand and associated during its lifetime, or its initial life at least, with all the major composers, Donizetti, Bellini, Puccini, Verdi, and in fact Rossini was the music director here, no less, between 1815 and 1852. Rossini was a very affable, likeable character, but he must have also been quite a businessman as well. He ran a gaming business in the foyers, gambling, and he made a lot of money out of it. And here we see the view back from the stage, where you can get an idea of the size of the opera house. It was very much Italy's leading opera house up until the 1850s, when La Scala in Milan rather took over. Here we see the Teatro Mercadante in Naples, which was a theatre built not exactly as a rival to San Carlo, but to complement San Carlo, and to avoid immediate competition, they tended to put on here lighter performances, comic opera and that sort of thing, and it's got a rather obviously plainer interior than San Carlo. Nonetheless, a number of famous events went on there, notably a so-called futurist evening in 1914, put on by Marinetti, the leader of the futurist movement, which was one of the pioneers of modernism in terms of architecture and industrial design. There we have the ceiling. And here we have the Grand Théâtre de Monet in Brussels. I won't say a great deal about it, but just again to emphasize the fact that the standard Baroque theatre became commonplace throughout Europe. It's called the Théâtre de Monet, which literally means money, because it was actually built on the former site of the Mint in Brussels, Mint being the word for a place where they make money, where they print, literally print money and make coins. And that is the view, of course, from the stage looking backwards. It's a very opulent theatre, and was, and still is indeed, a very important opera house in European terms. There's the ceiling with its chandelier. And La Fenice in Venice, of course, has always been one of the great opera houses. And this was put out to competition in 1789, remarkably at the very height of the French Revolution. It was as if people in Venice were completely oblivious, completely unaware of the French Revolution and what was going on, and what might have spread, you know, across Europe. But the project was put out to competition. The judges were variously an engineer, expert in civil and naval architecture, a physicist. A priest and a scenery designer, and there were 28 entries, and it was won by an architect called Selva. The architectural brief always sounds to me very sort of modern in that it was very specific. There had to be foyers where people could buy coffee and other things and so on. But it got built, but in 1836, inevitably it got burned down. So this theatre was rebuilt after 1836 in a kind of late empire style. And that's one of the boxes. But just to go back to the name Auditorium, the story doesn't stop there because it was undergoing renovation in 1996 when it burned down completely. And what happened was that during the renovation, the electrical contractor overran his time a little bit, so he had to pay more money as part of the contractual clause. And to avoid paying the money, the electrical contractor one night set fire to the theatre. And the police determined that it was arson, deliberate, you know, setting fire to a building, because the fire started in several different parts of the building at once that were all separated by fire compartmentation. So it was impossible that the fire had started accidentally. So rebuilding immediately began, and it was reopened several years later with the most amazing craftsmanship. The architect was Aldo Rossi, who was a famous architect who died a few years ago, and so the theatre now is restored to its former occupants. And here we have the Royal Opera House Covent Garden on the right-hand side, and on the left-hand side the Floral Hall, which was a conservatory made of glass and cast in wrought iron, which was used for flower displays and things in Victorian times in the 19th century. But during a renovation in the 1990s, it became part of the Opera House and became a foyer, a very useful foyer for the theatre. And that is the interior of the theatre, which was designed by the son of Sir Charles Barry, who built the Palace of Westminster with Augustus Welwyn Pugin. The son of Charles Barry, Edward Middleton Barry, also had a brother who was an engineer who built Tower Bridge across the Thames. I might just mention that in the renovation recently, one of the focuses of the renovation was to make opera more equal, make it more accessible. So instead of going in through the front entrance, if you paid a lot of money for your ticket and arrived in a very swanky Mercedes, and the cheaper seat holders would have to go through a little side entrance so that they wouldn't be seen. In the recent renovation, everybody arrived through the same place, and so it was part of an effort to make opera going more accessible. And that is the Floral Hall as it is now, which is a wonderful space, and you can have champagne or whatever before going in to see the performance. Now we come to two of the most important, or the two most important opera houses of the 19th century. I want you to look very closely at this one, and remember it for looking at the second one, which I'll show you in a few moments' time. This is the Paris Opera House by Charles Garnier, and it was the centrepiece of the renovation of Paris by Haussmann, who cut through all the great boulevards in Paris, and this sat as the centrepiece at the end of one of the grand boulevards. And Charles Garnier's whole idea was to make a sequence of getting into the opera house so that the whole thing was a kind of ritual, and people come in their carriages down the boulevard, which was part of the approach, part of the process of getting into the theatre, and then they would go through doorways with mirrors where they could glance at themselves to make sure their hair was just right and so on, and then they would go up the grand staircases towards the auditorium itself, and you could see your balconies and look at everybody else, and people would look at you, and this is the main foyer, very, very grand, very palatial, and then eventually you arrive inside in the auditorium, which again is standard in terms of architectural form, and Garnier himself admitted that he knew nothing about acoustics at all, and that it was rather like, he said, a clown going up in a balloon. He knew absolutely nothing about acoustics, but he simply did what he thought was best, and indeed, of course, it is a very fine opera house. It was completed in 1870 on the eve of the Franco-Prussian War, and so for quite a while it wasn't actually used. It was used initially as a military store and a base for launching hot air balloons during the siege of Paris, which was the only means of communication with the outside world. But this is the second of the opera houses which I want to show you. It is the opera house of Richard Wagner, the composer. It's the Festspielhaus in Bayreuth, which Wagner had built himself using the architect Otto Bruckwald, and it's specifically designed around his own operas. Wagner, being the romantic that he was, initially had the idea of building a temporary wooden theatre in a Swiss meadow and performing the opera Siegfried's Death three times in 1 week, and then setting fire to the building with the original score inside, so that the music would only live on into history as a legend. Luckily for us, he didn't do that, but he built this opera house instead. And it was quite unique in terms of opera houses at the time, because the auditorium is in a fan shape, an amphitheatre shape, so that everybody was equal before Wagner's music. There was no elitism. You were equal when witnessing his music dramas. And the stage itself has a double proscenium, the proscenium being a sort of picture frame thing around the stage. So here it has a double proscenium to give a sense of depth, so that you're really sitting looking at the action in the distance. So you're witnessing the spectacle. And the orchestra pit creates what was called a mystical abyss in German, a mystischer Abgrund, which further detached the performers or the audience from the performers on stage. The staging of the operas was very, very elaborate, although I can never but think that Wagner's operas must have quite often looked like pantomime to our eyes if we'd seen them. For example, the Rhine Maidens were made to simulate swimming in swimming machines. They had swimming machines where the Rhine Maidens would paddle. But whereas modern opera stars tend to be really very glamorous indeed, and slender, in the 19th century, opera singers were frequently, how shall I put it, simply fat. And so you can imagine them in these swimming machines looking completely absurd. And then Wagner commissioned a dragon to be built in London, and it was shipped out in two halves, but unfortunately only half the dragon arrived in Bayreuth, because the other half was shipped to Beirut in the Lebanon. And here we have the pit, the Mistershire Apgrund, which I mentioned, and the feature of it is that it was covered by a canopy so that the audience couldn't see the musicians, but also because it was partially covered, it gave the music a very strange sort of remote sound. And although Wagner devised this hooded pit for visual reasons, nonetheless, it did give this peculiar quality to the sound. And the pit was designed for 130 musicians, so it also had the useful effect of muting the sound slightly so as not to overpower the singers on stage. And that is simply a plan of the theatre. It had a great influence on early 20th century German theatre design, which I won't go into, but it became very influential, and it also became influential later in the 20th century in American vaudeville theatre and also cinema design. So it all started with Wagner. And there's the exterior. And the point I want to make here relating to Charles Garnier is that I mentioned that the process of getting inside the opera house in Paris was very much part and parcel of the experience. You journey through the fine boulevards of Paris and arrive at the opera house and go inside. And here you did exactly the same with the Festspielhaus when going to a Wagner opera, but the difference was that you left behind Bayreuth itself and you journeyed on a short journey through the countryside in order to be, as it were, cleansed before witnessing Wagner's operas. So there we have the contrast, the opulence of Garnier, the simplicity of Wagner, and the two different philosophies. And here we have quite different now, and I'm coming into the very last few slides, so I'm almost through. Just to present a coda, to use musical terminology, here we have the Palau de la Música in Barcelona, which was really built as a concert hall, but it's a marvellous interior. And Armet Ertu asked me rather nervously, do you think we can include it in the Palaces of Music book if it's not really an opera house? So I said to him, well, it's not an opera house, but a very great deal of opera has been performed there in concert performances, and all the great opera stars of the world have been there. So Armet was, he breathed a sigh of relief and very much enjoyed photographing this interior. But I have to say that it actually works very well acoustically for opera because it's largely made of thin glass windows, as you can see, including the roof. And glass is a little bit like thin wood panelling in that it absorbs the lower frequencies and reflects the upper frequencies, which, as you know by now, is a very desirable thing in a building for speech. And here we have couple more views of it, including a further view of the ceiling, which is very like a Tiffany lantern, isn't it? And here we have the actual opera house in Barcelona, the Teatro de Liceu, and this theatre burnt down in 1994. So what you see here is a complete rebuild, once again, like La Fenice. So everything that you see there is actually new. And there is the ceiling. So we have still been building these Baroque opera houses 300 years after they were invented. But just to finish off, there are two or three very recent opera houses that are of their time that have been built. And this one is in Lyon, known as the Opera Nouvelle, after the architect Jean Nouvel, a well known French current present day architect. Nouvel took an existing shell of the building, which had a nondescript fridge inside, demolished everything, kept the outer walls, and built this rather extraordinary superstructure, providing extra accommodation which they needed, which Nouvel called like a jewel box. He said it was the analogous to a jewel box, the lid of the jewel box, which you would open, as it were. And that is the interior, very much a black, what I call a black box interior. But notice these stepped boxes or galleries, because that goes back to the illustration I showed you of the Galli di Vienna opera house in Verona. It's a good device for improving sight lines. And there we have the theatre looking from the stage. Very much a traditional opera house. You know, there's no innovation there. It's a truly tried and tested formula, but in present day clothes, and perhaps, you know, appealing much more to younger people, new young audiences, which I think is a very important aim when designing a building of this sort. That's the rehearsal space at the very top of the jewel box lid. And here we have a new opera house in Valencia, in Spain, designed by the Spanish architect Santiago Calatrava. And I will leave it entirely to your own taste as to whether you like it or not. I personally find the white balconies rather stark and distracting, but you must make up your own mind. And that is the exterior, which Calatrava says was designed according to the analogy of an ocean liner, with decks and circular porthole windows, and it sits within a lake, and so it has this rather sculptural exterior, analogous, as I say, to an ocean liner, although a lot of critics think it looks more like a cycling helmet. And finally, the new opera house in Oslo, designed by a firm of architects called Snøhetta. Snøhetta is the name of the highest mountain in Norway. But here we see, once again, a very traditional interior, but with galleries with very warm fruit wood cladding, creating a very warm feeling in the auditorium. And in the top, there is a very modern interpretation of a crystal chandelier using many thousands of crystals that are illuminated. Here we see a view of the stage. And finally, almost finally, we see the foyer, a sort of glass box containing this oak middle, where you go upstairs and go into the auditorium itself. And then really finally, we have the exterior, which is clad in Carrara marble, and the roofs are tilted right down to the ground, so that you can literally walk over the rooftop. And again, it sort of symbolizes the democracy of opera, the move towards making the building accessible to everybody, as well as, in the case of Oslo here, opening up what was a very derelict but historic part of the waterfront in Oslo. So thank you very much indeed.
Thank you for your I just inquire is, why did you not include the opera's movement into this story? İnternetteki operalardan niye bahsetmedi?
Is there a reason why you're not speaking about the opera houses in England?
Why I haven't talked about it? Well, I did mention the Royal Opera House of Covent Garden in London. Of course, there are other opera houses. There is the English National Opera, which is also the other principal opera house in London. There is some as well, so there are other opera houses. I have selected the most significant ones from around Europe, but the history of opera in London is of course very, very rich, but as I said, the theatres tended to burn down and get rebuilt very frequently. So the opera houses that I've shown are those that I consider most significant and perhaps can tell the most interesting stories.
I have a quick question.
Yes.
Have you been to the opera houses in Turkey?
No, I haven't. The wonderful as an experience.
But you have heard the story of Istanbul One, the Atatürk Cultural Center, which is being built?
Absolutely, yes. And of course, there is the marvelous exhibition on at the moment at South Galata. It's a very impressive project. I think very worthy of a book, actually, because I see the building as very reflective of its time. And I think that there are very interesting parallels with other early 1950s buildings elsewhere. For example, the Royal Festival Hall in London, which of course is not an opera house, it's a concert hall, but it has a very similar story to tell, I suspect. And so I wish the project well, and when it's renovated, I definitely have it on my list to visit.
And maybe next time we'll welcome you to the Opera House in Izmir.
Yeah.
Well, that's a good one.
Başka sorusu olan var mı? What about Sydney?
Sydney? Well, yes, of course, I was confining, or we could, Ahmet and myself confines the book just to European opera houses. The Sydney Opera House was something of a misnomer from the start. In other words, the name Opera House was rather misleading because the competition was won by the Danish architect Jørn Utzon, and the competition entry was just very, very simple sketches on what Americans call butter paper, or you know, tracing paper, and so it won. But nobody had thought about how to actually build it. And when it was built, it actually ended up not really staging opera at all, and the interior ended up being a concert hall rather than an opera house. So, as I say, opera house is rather misleading as a word. And of course, it took hugely long and enormous expense to build. But of course, having said that, it is the most incredible cultural icon that Australia could have ever wished for, because it has culturally put Australia on the map. So even though it was very expensive to build, and it was very difficult, and there was a lot of argument, it has become a very important international icon. And after all, when you think that the Gothic cathedrals, say in Britain, took hundreds of years to build, and the great cathedral of Winchester, when they built the tower, it fell down 6 times before they managed to get it to stand up. So the problem in the 20th century of building simple little opera house was nothing to, compared to building a cathedral.
Thank you very much. Just a quick question from the other room. You mentioned that the opera houses burn out real fast.
Yes.
In a matter of 10, 15 to 20 years.
Yes.
What were the particular reasons? Obviously fire, but caused by... would you like to elaborate on
that? Yes, I mean, the reason is very simple. The lighting was with candles. They invented lime light, where they burned lime, which glowed very brightly to create the stage lighting. But the whole thing was very, very hazardous. And even when gas was introduced from 1822, again, you know, one was talking about naked flames. So there was a great fire hazard. The patrons at operas would actually smoke cigarettes and things. And in fact, in concerts, in the 20th century in London, they had smoking concerts where everybody had to take along a packet of cigarettes and smoke. So it was all very hazardous, and there were no fire precautions particularly. As I say, it was only at the end of the 19th century that building codes were introduced where there had to be, for example, a safety curtain, an iron curtain that always comes down nowadays in theatres. But none of that existed. So if a fire started on the stage, it spread to the auditorium. It was recognised in the 18th century that it was a hazard, and in fact, it was advocated by some architects at the time that theatres should be built of stone, but lined with thin wood panelling furred out on battens from the stone. So the problem was well recognised, but not really tackled until the late 19th century.
As far as we are concerned, the most important feature of the opera house is it is acoustics. In Rome, as we know, they had some wooden openings of the orchestras to improve the acoustics. You also refer to some wood panelings and tin glasses to improve its acoustics in some of the opera houses. So, in today's world, in the modern ones, what sort of improvements, innovations are employed to make acoustics better? Or are there any, just by curiosity?
The difference between historical situations and today is that, of course, we have a great understanding of acoustics, and the main thing that we are able to get right nowadays is the basic shape of the auditorium. So it's possible to experiment with new shapes, provided they work well acoustically. So the basic shape of the auditorium is something that we now understand. So we don't simply nowadays have to copy historic models. But as I say, the standard theatre form became a tried and tested model. You mentioned about awnings over the top of Roman amphitheatres. These were known as the velarium. They often had canvas stretched across the tops of amphitheatres, that was, you know, largely to keep the sun off the audience, but it had the beneficial effect, rather like the thin wood paneling, of reflecting the upper frequency sound and absorbing the lower frequency sound. And in fact, circus tents have very good acoustics for hearing whip cracks, because the canvas actually reflects upper frequency sound very efficiently. So there are all these little incidents that have lasted throughout history, which are interesting and have all, I dare say, added to our knowledge in the present day.
Başka sorusu olan? bize geldiğiniz için çok teşekkür ederiz ve gelecek Perşembe günü tekrar buraya bekleriz. Yani sabah yemeğimize gelecek. Bir de yarın gönderiyoruz. Ufak anketler yaptık.